Good evening, everyone. Yep, we always stick to something. We don't do software. We version control the car. So I'm on the API team at GitHub. I slightly contest that API endpoints are easy to hit sometimes. hence this talk, or at least what they do when you hit them, let's put it like that. I live in Berkshire. Most of GitHub is still remote. We are 67% remote. And in terms of engineering employees doing anything to do with technology, we are probably close to 85% remote now. So anybody asking about GitHub London office, no, we don't have one. We'd not like to get one anytime soon. Sorry, you'll have to learn to like your own company or work in coffee shops. So, feature flagging. I'm pretty sure most of this audience has a good idea of what this is. The other talks will give us a bit of background on it. But it's enabling us to turn things on conditionally, not just like a, is this user logged in type of conditional. We have different options at GitHub. We use the Flipper Jam by John Lunamaker, who was an employee for a long while at GitHub. Sorry, LaunchDarkly, nothing personal. This stuff has been in our code base for probably 10 years now, so yeah, it's been there a while. So we have specific options that we can turn on for, and there are kind of variations within these, but these are the key ones. So individuals is a big one. So one of the examples I'm going to talk to you about in a little bit by the API, that's definitely been used. We also have groups. Now these can be special groups, so if you're in the actions beta, any of you, that is a group to feature flag that onto you. We have dark shipping to turn things on and perform experiments. We also have the gradual roll out that Michael covered quite a lot in his talk, so you know, 5%, 10% in 5% increments. We don't tend to do anything that's like mobile or language specific, primarily because GitHub is not localized yet. It is in a future long-term roadmap, and also because up until the recent announcement we didn't have a mobile client for a long time, but we do now. We also have an enable / disable master override. The enable is just kind of when you got to 95% or you've got a group and then you're suddenly giving it to everybody. That's when we use the enable for that. And for disabling, it's like, uh-oh, everything's going red, everybody's getting paid, let's turn this thing off. One of the things that we do at GitHub a lot is we eat our own dog food. Unfortunately, amazing, but so we run our company on GitHub. It's a thing that people maybe are not aware of, but legal, HR, people like that, they have to use GitHub issues to do their job. Not the privacy aspect of HR things, obviously, but things like documentation and everything else is run through GitHub issues, merge requests into markdown files and the like. And likewise, we will pretty much always staff ship something before we release it, which does get slightly confusing as a staff member because it's like, can I talk about this feature yet or not? but it is a great way for people to actively use things in their day-to-day job. And really test it out rather than just like, well, I think it kind of does what users want it to do. So this is a process we follow. So we have a flag controlled code change. We have compliance code reviews by GitHub, which are, well, we have code owners for areas of files. The code base is huge. We do have some services, but the majority of the code is still in the monolith. And even in those services, we have code owners. So we have people that are, you have to have been there 90 days to end up on one of these teams. They don't put new hovers on those. But you're taking responsibility for signing off on some kind of functionality. Not literally if it kind of fails, the developer that's doing it is still primarily responsible. So we will often suggest people put something behind the flag if we're not sure, or if it could impact something. But this is where it is great having these reviews spread across the company because, as I say, I'm the API team. I can talk to you an awful lot about our rate limiting or how we can write a GraphQL resolver. What I can't tell you is the details of how a certain feature set of issues works, for example, or how project boards work. So yeah, we make a lot of use of flag control changes, even for small things, just to be able to then test them on real-world data. We have some customers using our cloud version who have massive, massive numbers of users and repos and large repos within those. And they mostly, we have great relationships with all of them, and we will talk to them about trying things out if we're worried about scale, for example. So doing that testing in production, we would never opt in individuals or groups without prior consent. Our support team, we call them support accounts, they are brilliant go-betweens for us on that, because generally we're finding if we're helping people, we're solving a problem, they'll say, can we flag you into this to see how it's working for you? Have we solved the problem you've got, and have we truly solved it, rather than what we think the solution is? Most people are willing to do that. We will then optionally enable for all users, and I say optionally because it could be that we don't want to. We've realised it's not the best solution, it's not able to scale, whatever the reason. And we will then have a PR to either remove the flag or the code. We don't leave these flags in code forever, otherwise our dashboard would have become unmanageable. There's probably only about five or six groups at the minute and so many in a scrolling page of features, which is not many given the number of developers we have working on our product. So, okay, kind of the key things I wanted to talk about are about flagged API changes. Because we've done some of that in the last few months, so it's kind of fresh in my mind and maybe useful to some of you. So sometimes we have to make breaking changes to the API with no notice. I would like to caveat that before anybody freaks out with that we only ever do that in security situations, and I can name you one of those in the year that I've been at GitHub that's affected the API. So, you know, we don't make those decisions lightly, and our security team don't make those decisions lightly. So for those, we would never flag them. If it's a security hole, we're going to close that hole regardless of the impact on you, because we take that very, very seriously. What we will use flagged API changes for, however, are for changes in behaviour. And by that, I don't mean something that we need to put into a deprecation cycle and a new version of. But where there's an edge case, where there's a bit of processing that we hadn't thought about, or a flow through permissions and abilities and everything else that we hadn't thought about. So a recent example of this is we have the concept of spammy users. We also have DMCA takedown requests that we have to honor. Those mark repositories as taken down, and they are considered differently from things not existing, and they're also considered differently from you not having permission to see them. We actually tell you that it's been taken down in the repo case. And we had a user who had a really odd use case with one of these where he was getting the wrong error code and he didn't understand why. So what we did is we made a change in the resolution of that would change the status code, which is a breaking change in REST API. However, we figured that this would not be affecting very many users, if any, other than this one user. We also thought that we actually needed to try it with his particular set of repositories users, the permissions they've been granted, and everything else. So we put that behind a feature flag, and the developer that was working on it, my team, and the person that made the bug report were the only two people that were flagged into that initially. So they did some testing, tried some things out, had conversations through the support channel, and that enabled us to verify that we had made the right fix for him, and then satisfy ourselves that we'd solved it in a more general case. So then we've got these two people opted in. What our system then allows us to do is to say, okay, we'll take them out of there, or leave them in, depending on your choice. We took our developer out of there, but we left the end user in, so nothing would then change for him in the short term. We then started doing the gradual rollout that I won't particularly go over because Michael did that earlier. But then we were able to do that, and I think we jumped sort of 5, 10, then maybe 25, then 50, and then a full rollout for somebody who was asking about that. Again, it's a judgment call, the developers or the managers of the developers, depending on the level of risk, will make that call. We'll be watching dashboards, we'll be looking at logs, we'll leave stuff running for a period of time. It's not that we flip it to 5% and give it 10 minutes. Be nice. We have a lot of traffic through our API, but yeah, we need to give it longer than that. So that was has proved that, you know, feature flags are really valuable for us. And then maybe 3 weeks later, so that's kind of your overall timeline there, we took the feature flag out of the code. But it gave us time to do everything that Michael talked about in terms of being able to roll back if we'd had to be able to turn it off if we had to delay it until we had to do a deprecation change if there was a wide impact because lots of people were encountering this and getting the wrong status code. So definitely real value in feature flags for us in that regard. Another thing we do is to involve users in experiments. This is not so much A/B testing, though that does happen at GitHub, but as in the AVR team, we don't really have a UI as such, so that's not something we have to kind of concern ourselves with. But this is experiments around things like rate limiting. We're currently exploring changing some of the strategies we have there, and we wanted to understand what that would do for specific users, specific high traffic users. I mean, we get something like, I think last month, 680,000 requests a minute through our API. So we have a lot of volume, but that doesn't necessarily help us see whether, we can see somebody's rate limited or not rate limited, but if we change that algorithm, we're not going to see the difference there. So one of the things we've, not myself, but I've been working on other things around rate limiting, but a couple of members of the team have been working on very, very recently is they've implemented a alternative rate limiting algorithm alongside the existing rate limiting algorithm, and they've opted in certain of our large integrators who we have good relationships with, as I mentioned. And what we're doing is we're logging out of all of this data to say they would have been rate limited by this, but they aren't being by our existing system, or vice versa, or it's all fine. Or so the differences between the two, and this has been running now for maybe 6 weeks, so we're planning to keep running it slightly longer to make sure we can capture a good amount of data to make help inform these decisions. But this also means that we're not just going to say, right, we've decided these numbers are going to be great for rate limiting, we're just going to do it, never mind the users. We've got too large a user base to do that with. And also, I mean, I've used and consumed many APIs. I'd be annoyed if somebody did that to me. So we don't want to annoy people. We do also do for some performance things in real world scenarios. We have a thing at GitHub that we call science experiments, possibly where one of our stickers came from. Although we don't use test tubes in these experiments, it's frowned upon. Health and safety don't like that. So what we would do is we would say if we changed the way we resolve this endpoint, and we can enable that for a percentage of users, although that's done in code, subtly different to the Flipper implementation, but the principle is the same. And again, we can log things out to our statistics platform, our analytics platform, to push data to our data pipeline and order consumer if we want to run a long-term experiment. We've got masses of data that we do use to inform what we do. And one thing I wanted to say over all of this is that this is definitely about controlled access. We have, and do abuse, I apologise, previews in our API. Previews should exist for a period of time, then either graduate or be removed, but that's a different conversation and a different argument. But we would never do this for something that we think should be under a preview flag that we want people to opt into using and play around with and see what they think. This is specifically about something we need to be in control of to potentially sort of turn off immediately. We wouldn't, again, from a good API owner standpoint, we wouldn't turn off a preview flag without a deprecation period either. Whereas with a feature flag, everything goes, we will turn it off if we have to protect ourselves. So I would definitely ask you to view those things very differently. So I just want to give you some closing thoughts here and let you go back to any food that's left, grab a beer, whatever. But it's important to be able to experiment in production. I have had some prior bosses that would disagree with me here, but it allows you to make progress and it allows you to involve your customers. Now, I'm speaking from the API's perspective, and we have a lot of users, and we're in a privileged position that we are big enough that we can ask them for feedback. However, we get an enormous amount of knowledge out of that, and they intend most of the time like being involved and feeling heard. So it also builds kind of rapport with your community as well. And I think for many of us, that's an underrated part of our job. We're not just sitting writing code in isolation. It's how it's being used and what people want to do with it and how we can make their lives better. So I definitely would like to advocate for feature flagging, continuous deployment, lots of testing. And yeah, 15 times a day for tests? Nah. Continuous deployment at GitHub, probably thousands of times a day. So flaky tests to us were kind of a bit more of a problem. But yeah, all of that is, having not worked with a lot of us before GitHub, I am a huge fan of all of it. And I encourage you to explore it if you haven't done any of it. Thank you. Like something, how does the ripple effect of that, I think, go across the other systems and into microservices and so forth? I would say it's very easy because of the monitoring that we've got set up. We have many dashboards for different areas and different things. We make use of incident commanders as well as on-call shifts who will have maybe an awareness of what's going on. Everybody that is on call, again, you don't do that when you first join a company. You have to have a certain level of experience. Learns to look at what's recently been deployed or what feature flags are enabled. So I would say that's not something I'm particularly concerned about. Also, if it's something that you're changing that you think might impact the database writes, for example, you would talk to the database team beforehand. That kind of level of responsibility is expected of engineers. At GitHub, quite rightly. So I would say on the whole, we have the odd blip, as everybody does, where something is affecting a downstream system, but we have pretty good boundaries and can see where things are starting to fall apart because of the variety of dashboards monitoring the different systems. So if it's like, this is all green, but that one's gone red, then that's an indicator that certain things might be happening and we know where to go look.